So before my brain injury, when I saw something move, it looked like it was moving smooth and was continuous. But after my injury, when something moved across my field of view, it looked choppy and discrete, like I was watching a video frame by individual frame, only in real time. And I was absolutely entranced and mesmerized by the fact that this must be how our brain constructs a moving image, just like a video camera with individual discrete pictures. The way reality actually worked turned out to be much richer, far deeper, and more science fiction-like than I ever could have imagined. Everything that is moving relative to a matrix or a grid structure like pixels on a television screen. When I was thinking about motion, was that an object's motion, when it moves, its total motion through space and time always equals exactly the speed of light. Everything in the universe displays wave-like behavior, even time itself. Even us, we're waves, and every sense that is evolved is dependent on waves. Sight, sound, taste, touch, smell, the sense of magnetism in animals, they're all dependent on waves. For instance, if we smell something, it's believed by many that we are not only detecting the shape of the molecule, but its vibrational frequency. When we feel something that's hot or cold, the reason why it feels hot is because molecules are vibrating faster. And if it feels colder, it's because they're going slower. So cold really doesn't exist. Cold is just less vibration, so it's just less heat. When we hear something, we're dependent on sound waves. And when we see something, we're dependent on light waves. And what's so amazing is that waves change based on the position and the velocity of the observer and the observed. We are waves as we travel through space-time. For instance, everything, including you and this building and the planet, we're all vibrating at a certain frequency, and we're all moving through space. So as you vibrate and move, you're making a wave through space. So here we all are, vibrating, sitting on the planet Earth, which is vibrating as it moves around the sun, which is vibrating as it moves around the galaxy. So we are literally a wave within a wave within a wave within a wave. My shirt's blue, right? It's not blue and red and green, you know, at the same time. If I were to sing a note right now, I would be singing that one note. I wouldn't be singing all notes in existence. But actually, my shirt is every color. And if I did sing a note, you could say that, yes, I am singing every single note in existence. There's something called the Doppler effect, and it describes how waves change based on motion. And so we've all heard a car drive by us. And you know how a car drives by us? It goes, and it changes pitch. The reason it changes pitch is because short wavelengths of sound, we hear that as a high pitch, and long wavelengths of sound, we hear as a low pitch. So as the car is moving towards you, or towards me, that sound wave is getting kind of squished together as those wave fronts get closer, and I hear the pitch getting higher, and then the car goes vroom, and the pitch gets lower as the car moves away from me because those wave fronts are stretching out and getting further apart, so I hear the pitch getting lower. But now, if we add relativity to it, and we say that the car is moving away from the person on the left and towards the person on the right. Well, relative to the person on the left, the waves are stretching out and getting longer, so that person hears a low pitch. But at the exact same time, the person on the right, the waves are compressing and getting closer together, they hear the pitch getting higher. And the person in the car, they're traveling with the sound source or with the wave source, so they hear a medium pitch and no sound change at all. And then what you do right there is you stop and say, what sound is the car actually making for real? Is it making a low pitch to the person on the left, a high pitch to the person on the right, or a medium pitch to the person in the car? And it's actually making all three sounds relative to who's looking at it. And then you say, imagine there's an infinite number of people, and they're all looking at that car, and they're all moving at different velocities. Every single person hears a different sound, and every single reality is real and valid. It's just that they're relative. And so you know that old question of, if a tree falls in the forest and nobody's around to hear it, does it make a sound? It doesn't. It makes a wave, and only if something's there with sound receptors does it make a sound. All the other realities that you don't see, that you don't experience, they are all just as real. It's just that by you, they're unrealized.
when I talked about pi, what I saw was something similar to the pixel analogy. I saw a shape that was forever getting smoother and smoother and smoother as you sliced it into smaller slices, and it would forever approach a circle but never reach it. It's 8^3 power. He could be talking about 8 × 8 × 8, which is 512. But what I saw was literally a cube, that it was composed of smaller and smaller cubes. And this cube, you can see it has 8 cubes on each side, and you square those 8 × 64, and you stack those 64 8 high, and you get 512. When I talked about fusion, what I saw was this, a geometric timed implosion that would get the atoms close enough together so that they could fuse. The interference patterns were identical to many of my drawings. Here we have actual interference patterns and a drawing of a fractal that I drew. And it gave me this great feeling that I was on the right track. I didn't want to be that crazy guy who thought he saw math everywhere but really didn't. And so it gave me this feeling that, yes, I was on the right track and learning the right way. So that is my mission, to try to inspire students, to try to help create scientists.
Thank you.
Thank you.